I didn't do anything yet. All right. How's everyone doing? So that's Friday. Makes me happy. Classes are over. When are exams? Next week?
Yeah.
That's why everyone's like, why am I here? Please pass the fatwa saying I can cheat. Yeah. So, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen wa salatu wa salamu ala afdal imam anbiya wa muslimin sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsan ila yawm al-din. Allahumma ja'alna minhum. Ameen. So basically what I just said in Arabic really quickly was a dua, and it was the initial praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because in any gathering we always want to start by praising Allah. Whether or not you're hanging out with friends, whether or not you're starting your class, whatever you're doing, you want to get together and just say Alhamdulillah. So everyone say Alhamdulillah. You want to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you want to thank Him. Why do we thank Him? Well, you know, look at yourself, look around you. Just the mere fact that you can look around and your eyes are functioning and you have the ability to see and to recognize and to appreciate, that's a mere sign of itself of why we should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why we should always be grateful to Him, to God Almighty. And then we ask for God's peace and blessings to be sent upon the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Why the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Well, if you learn about him, you'll know the sacrifices that he made for us, the things that he did for us that allow us to be who we are. You know, you read a lot of stories that are very interesting. Some of the companions once were walking with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you know, he said that he can't wait to meet his brothers. And in the Arabic language, we learned that the male gender is universal as well, so it covers females as well. So we can translate it as brothers and sisters. He couldn't wait to meet his brothers and sisters. And he was walking with people. So imagine like I'm walking with you guys, right? And we're just walking down to like Mason Pond Parkway, because it's the only thing on campus that I know what the name of it is. So the Mason Pond Garage. And I'm like, man, I can't wait to meet, you know, a couple brothers. And then you guys are like, awkward. Like, we are a couple brothers, right? And I'm like, no, not you guys. Some other people. That's what the Prophet ﷺ did. They were all like, Ya Rasulullah, aren't we your brothers? And he was like, yeah, you're my companion. But my brothers are the ones who will come after me. And they'll trust me, they'll love me, they'll believe in me and the message that I brought, but they'll have never have seen me. So even when we weren't with the Prophet ﷺ, even though we weren't with him, the Prophet ﷺ already prophesied and predicted our coming, and he wanted to meet us. So imagine that day on the Day of Judgment when we go running to the Prophet ﷺ, and it's like being reunited with old friends. Someone that wanted to meet you and you wanted to meet them. So we ask Allah to send his peace and blessings upon the Prophet ﷺ. And at the very end I say, Allahumma ja'alna minhum. Right? Oh Allah, make us from amongst them. And then I say Ameen. So everyone say Ameen. Very good. Okay. That's the talk for tonight. I really appreciate you guys inviting me. I'm just going tonight's talk is it up here? Yeah, 180 degrees, Project Transformation, with Abdel-Rahman Murphy. The last part was not as important. The first part's very important. And what's interesting is that the concept of transformation is something that is central to Islam. Something that Muslims should be constantly involved in transformation and in revolution all the time. There's never a point where we stop revolution in ourselves or transforming ourselves. We're constantly working on it. And the focus of transformation in Islam, a lot of us are involved in community transformation. How many of you were big fans of the Occupy movement? Anyone? No one? Okay, you all are probably very wealthy then. Okay. So how many of you were fans of the Egyptian Revolution?
Woo!
Yeah, of course. Egyptians in the house? Yeah. I'm half Egyptian. My mom's Egyptian. I'm from Iskandaria, so. I know what Zalabia is, and Kushari, and Buftik, and Makarana Bishamam, and all these, I know what they are. Obviously, I know what they are, okay. You know, everyone's a fan of the Egyptian Revolution. A lot of people were fans of different kinds of revolutions all over the world. And inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives victory to the Syrian brothers and sisters who are currently revolting, Ameen. But really, what the focus of Islam is, before communal revolution, before human revolution, is individual revolution. And this is what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam preached. And this is what he taught. And this is what, for the first, you know, half of his message, when he was given the Quran, the revelation of the Quran by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is what he focused on, was individual transformation. Now, the question then comes, or you know, begs to be asked, why then do we focus so much on communal transformation? Why? What was the focus of transforming community when a lot of ourselves, we need ourselves transformation. Well, if we look at the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we see that he focused on individuals. He focused on people. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you guys don't know who Umar ibn Khattab was? Do you guys know who he was before he became Muslim? What's a famous thing that he did? Everyone should know. Okay, so one thing he used to do is he used to build an idol of dates, right? And he actually, at one time, he was known to be crying once. They saw him, he was crying, and they said, this way, why is he crying? And then he started laughing. They said, okay, that's kind of a weird emotional mixture. And they started crying again, and they started laughing. So he was constantly alternating between crying and laughing. So they went and said, yeah, Omar, why are you like having this like emotional shift? And he said, I'm crying because I remembered in times of ignorance, I actually assembled an idol, something that I worshipped out of dates. And so I'm crying because I was in such a state where my heart was in such ghafla, negligence of God, that I used to worship dates. And then they're like, well, why did you start laughing? He goes, I remember when I used to get hungry, I used to eat my idol. Right? I used to eat my idol. And so you turn this man, okay, that's a more lighthearted example. But to get real serious on you guys, real talk, this man killed his baby daughter. And we tell the story as if like, oh, Omar killed his baby daughter. Everyone's like, OMG. And we're like, yeah, like hashtag, oh my God, right? But no, think about this for real. He killed his baby daughter. Have any of you ever held an infant before? And what's one word you would use to describe holding an infant? What's one word you would use to describe that infant? Undescribable. Wow, we got a philosopher, okay. You're right. It's undescribable. You can't really describe it. But what would you describe that baby in that moment? Innocent, very good. Pure, I'm looking for something else, but
fragile.
Thank you, mashallah. Go, you go, pink job. Okay, so fragile, right? Delicate. I would even say helpless. Helpless. I mean, it's a crude thought to have, but imagine at that moment you control the life of that child. You could very easily end it. You could very easily alter it. That's why whenever you ask to hold a newborn baby, the mom was always like, can you like sanitize your hands first, right? And then like make sure you wear these big oven mitts and sit down on the pillow and make sure, because they're very scared, because at that moment that baby's life is fragile, right? Very delicate. Omar took that baby and buried it in the ground and suffocated it with dirt until it choked on dirt and died. And again, we tell the story as if it's like, oh yeah, the baby died. No, the baby suffocated on its own dirt, on the dirt that was covering it. And while he was digging the grave, actually one time he was crying because he remembered that while he was digging the grave for his own daughter that he was burying alive, the baby daughter, this creature, this amazing creation of God, has so much love for the parent that begot it, that the dirt that was coming up from the shovel when he was digging the grave for his daughter was getting into his beard, and his baby daughter was pulling the dirt out of his beard to clean up his father's beard, her father's beard. And he put that baby in the ground and covered it. This is the man who, because he met the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and because the Prophet focused on what? Individual transformation, that after the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, he said, after me, if there was to be another Prophet, it would be Omar. He went from that to this. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, when Omar walked on a street, when he took a path, when he hopped on Patriot Circle, right? Shaitan hopped off of Patriot Circle. He said that when he went on one way, Shaitan would look and be, oh, peace out, I'm taking the other way. Why? Because Omar's Iman was so strong. His revolution was so successful. His transformation was so complete that Shaitan didn't stand a chance. And this is the goal that us as individuals that we should have. We can focus on transforming community. We can focus on transforming our families. We can focus on the revolution. But really, if we haven't individually revolutioned ourselves, if we haven't individually revolted against our nafs, then it's all going to be for vain. It's all going to be for nothing, for naught. So when we talk about revolution, we talk about a couple things. We talk about recognizing our flaws. Who came today to the khutbah? Okay, cool. MashaAllah. The rest of you didn't pray Jummah. Stuck for a long time. No, you all prayed probably a better Jummah. It was probably a better khatib somewhere else, but I'm happy for you. But this talk tonight is not going to be very long, but we're going to hit a few points, right? One of the points we already hit in Jummah, and that is we have to be honest with ourselves. I used a phrase in the khutbah that I want everyone to remember. Write it down if you have a pen and paper. Muslims look at mirrors, not through windows. We look at our reflection. We don't look at other people. When we're talking about transformation, who came here tonight wanting a transformation? Raise your hand, please. Because who knows, maybe just raising your hand might be the reason why Allah lets us into Jannah, inshallah. You want a transformation. That's our niyyah. Our niyyah is to walk out of here better than we came in. And so we have to take an active role at that. And the first step at the active role of transforming is recognizing your own flaws. But human beings, we love checking out the flaws of other people. Right? We love it. You know, Isa, Jesus, peace be upon him, Prophet Jesus, there was a statement that is quoted to him where he said that when you point a finger at someone, the hand is reminding the pointer to check himself or herself how many times? 3 times before looking at the other person once. You guys see what I mean by that? The finger pointing out once, but before that, there's 3 fingers pointing back at the individual, saying, check yourself 3 times before you even think about someone else once. So the first step towards transformation is being honest, getting over the denial, right? Abdel-Rahman, do you have a problem with that? No, I'm cool, man, I'm straight. Really, because, you know, you said you don't have a problem getting it for Fajr, but you haven't got it for Fajr in like 3 years, right? No, I'm good, man, I wake up for Fajr when I want to. Getting over that denial is sometimes the most bitter pill to swallow. But it's the first step. If we can't take that first step towards transformation, then the rest of the battle is lost. The rest of the battle is lost. Now, why do we transform ourselves? What's the purpose? Who can offer a suggestion? What's the point? Why even come here? Why even try to work on bettering ourselves? To improve our faith, our iman. Very good. That's one. But again, why? Like, why do I want to improve my iman? Huh? Sorry? Did the sister raise her hand? No? Okay. Are there any girls in here named Imaan? We're not trying to improve you. Okay, you can improve yourself. But improve our Imaan. Aww. Okay, yes. To please Allah. But why? To gain Jannah. But why?
The purpose of our creation.
Why?
Because God says
okay, we're getting somewhere. Okay. But why? Why? Huh? This life is a test. Okay. But why? Listen, I work with youth, okay? I'm doing to you what they do to me. Brother Murphy, why do I do this? Because Allah told us to. But why? Because it'll get you, you know, His pleasure and His paradise. Why? Would you prefer hellfire? No, why? Right? You know what I realized the right answer is? And this is the truth. When I say the word halal, what am I saying? What does it mean, halal, in Arabic?
Permissible,
right? It means something that's free, that you're not chained down, it's permissible. When I say haram, what am I saying? What does it mean? Not permissible, forbidden. Scratch that. Don't think about those translations. Halal means good for you. Something that's good for you. If something's permissible, then Allah is informing us that by letting it be permissible and halal, it's good for us. It's something that benefits us. Eating food, good for you. Some of it is not good for you, which is the definition of haram, harmful for you. Anything that's forbidden, anything that Allah said, do not do that. Stay away from that. Don't get involved in that. Don't drink that. Don't touch that. Anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, don't, He's saying because it's bad for us. So when we talk about transformation and revolution, the focus is improving quality of our lives, this life and the next life. And a lot of people fail to realize that. I had a counseling session the other night. And the reason why I bring this up, I'm sorry, but it hit me so hard. There was a man who was married to his wife for 6 years. They had a 3-year-old son. And on their 6-year anniversary, he came home, not from Knoxville, by the way, from a different city. He came home and he told his wife, I don't want to be married to you anymore. On their 6-year anniversary. He did not go to Jared, right? He told her, I don't want to be married to you anymore. I'm no longer in love with you, right? When we sat down and talked about it as a group, when I was in his town, he said that the reason why he wasn't in love with her anymore was because he wanted to change his lifestyle, right? He wanted to start drinking. He had already started drinking alcohol. He wanted to be friends with girls. He said, "Why do we have to hold back from our relationship with females? Like, why can't we just like hang out with them and all this stuff? Why do we have to?" He basically said, I want to live my lifestyle and not worry about anything else. I want to do whatever I want and not have to worry about what my wife thinks. So if she's going to be bothering me about it, I don't want her anymore. That's what he said. After 6 years of being someone completely different, he changes. And when I looked at him in the face, and we sat with each other, I looked at him, right? The face that I so desperately wanted to punch, right? I looked at him and I said, do you think that this lifestyle is good for you? Do you think that by living this lifestyle, you're going to become a better person? I said, forget about religion. Because he goes, I don't know if I believe in Allah anymore. That's what he said, right? I was like, well, you know, Allah's still there, well, now you believe in him. Okay, but let's forget about that. Do you think this is good for you? He said, no. I said, so why would you do it? He was speechless. So when we talk about transforming ourselves, the why is always because Allah wants what is best for us. At the end of the day, this method of transformation is bettering our life, in this life and the next life. Now the other part to why is the motivation factor. This brother that I was talking to didn't seem very self-motivated. And this is something that I'm gonna say, because a lot of people come to me and say, Brother Murphy, I have these friends that I really wanna change. First of all, that's a very dangerous mindset, that you are changing someone. You're not changing anyone, right? People are changed by Allah. We act as ingredients in that change, by being their friends, by being their family. We're just ingredients, but the change is done by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself, right? Yes, no? Awesome, almost scared me. Okay, so we act as ingredients in that. So people say, I'm worried about my brother, he does this, or my sister is really concerning me, she's falling off on this side, right? This is the concern that people have. The number one key to successful transformation is self-motivation. You cannot motivate anyone else to do anything. That person has to be self-motivated. Whenever any parent comes to me, Brother Murphy, my son, he's going to hell. Why? Because he didn't take out the trash. Right? Like, serious, like, allegation. I had one father tell me, my son's a munafiq. And I was like, okay. Right? Very interesting. I was like, why? He goes, because he doesn't pray Fajr in the masjid. I was like, okay, that's intense, man. Right? He goes, and then he says afterward, he goes, yeah, you know, the Prophet ﷺ said the hardest prayers for a hypocrite to pray in the masjid are Fajr and Isha, right? Fajr and Isha. He goes, so, you know, transitive property, munafiq, right? I was like, don't change his name. Whatever you do, please. Just leave it to whatever it is, like mu'min, hopefully, right? I said, I asked the father, by the way, to finish the story. I said, did you pray? How old is your son? He was 18. I said, did you pray Fajr in the masjid when you were 18? He goes, no. I said, okay. Give him some time, right? Give him some time. But the self-motivation has to be there. The mother or the father coming to me and saying, we need you to change our son. We need you to help our son or our daughter. That's an erroneous belief. It's an erroneous step. The step that needs to be taken is that that person, us individually, need to realize that that transformation needs to be lit by ourselves. And the Prophet ﷺ taught this. The Prophet ﷺ, one time a young man came to him and said, Ya Rasulullah, can you give me a fatwa? Right? And he goes, Prophet ﷺ, you know, come ask him for a ruling or for permission. And he goes, what's the fatwa? And he goes, I want to commit zina with that girl. Can any of you imagine going up to your local imam and being like, yo, can I get a fatwa for zina real quick? Just real quick. You can FaceTime it, right? And the Prophet ﷺ is sitting in a gathering, and there's like a lot of companions around. And this kid comes up, and he basically goes, I want to have sex with that girl. Can you hook it up? And the hadith actually shows that he asked it in a very informal way. The Prophet ﷺ could have been like, pow, right? He could have just knocked him out. He could have done anything. He could have been like, you're disgusting. Oh my God, you pervert. Like, he could have called him out. All the other companions, he could have been like, man, line this kid up. Grab the stick, right? He could have done that. But what did he do? He realizes that motivation is intrinsically driven. That the motivation to change yourself is not something that anyone else can do. The Prophet ﷺ himself, إِنَّكَ لَمْ تَحْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ. Allah says that you cannot guide who you love. You cannot transform who you want. That transformation is individual. So what did he do? He put his hand on the chest of the young man, and he said, Allahumma tahir qalbik. May Allah purify your heart. He said it three times. The young man walked away from that gathering saying what? When I was going to the Prophet ﷺ, there was no action that I wanted to do more than that zina. And when I was walking, when I was walking towards the Prophet, there was no action I wanted to do more than that. When I was walking away, he said, there was no action that I hated more than that zina. The Prophet sparked something, but it was self-motivated. It wasn't the Prophet saying that. It wasn't the Prophet narrating this. That was that young boy, that young man. In another story that's very famous, the Prophet ﷺ was dealing with an older woman in Mecca in the early days. Was the message accepted or declined? In the early days. Declined or accepted? Who thinks it was accepted? Raise your hand. Okay, very good. Almost scared me again. Okay. It was declined. So much so that they used to abuse the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And so the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is dealing with an older woman, and he goes up to her and says, Ya Ummi. Have you guys heard this story before? No, interesting, okay. He goes up to this older lady and says, Ya Ummi, my mother. Is it actually his mom? No, his mother died when he was? 6. Yeah, between 5 and 7. 6, okay. So, rhymes with fix. 6, okay. So his mother died when he was 6 years old. He goes up to an older lady and says, Ya Ummi, why would he call her my mother? Out of love and respect, right? So for elders in the room, if you want love and respect from younger people, I'm sorry, young people, if you want respect, you gotta give some respect, right? Ya Ummi, right? What seems to be the problem? Because he was walking in the street one day and this old lady was packing up her thing, getting ready to move. Imagine if you were walking out on the street and you just see this old lady packing up a U-Haul truck all by herself. It'd be an odd sight. You'd be like, what's going on? Why is she packing all by herself? You know, why didn't she hire any movers? My mom, Egyptian to blood, never hired movers. She gave birth to movers, right? My brother and I. She said, I'm going to put all the work out. I'm going to pay a penny, right? She gave birth and fed movers. So this old lady didn't have any movers. And Ya'umi, what seems to be the problem? Where are you going? You seem frustrated. You seem like you're packing up your things. She goes, yeah, Ya'imni, which means my son. Why is she calling him her son? Love and respect. Elders, when young people give you respect, you got to give it back. Otherwise, you're not going to get it anymore. Ya'imni, there's this man named Muhammad who has come to this town. And he is preaching this message of one God, of do this, worship Allah alone. And it's tearing apart families. Mothers and daughters are fighting. Sons and fathers are splitting apart. Cousins are hating each other. And this isn't the group that I knew. This isn't the city that I grew up in. I want to leave. Does she know who she's talking to? Awkward. Very awkward moment, right? And she says, I hate this man. He's crazy. He's mentally retarded. He's stupid. He's a magician. He's an idiot. I want to leave. Again, at that moment, what would you do? I'd be like, lightning bolt, right? I'm going to go hop for something bad to happen, right?
I just calmly say.
You would what?
I just calmly say,
no, I'm not. But that'd be more awkward. And she's like, right? And then she realizes it's you. But anyways, so we'll see what he did. His response was much more close than my lightning bolt response, right? So he looks at her and he says, I'm sorry you feel that way. I hope that you don't commit to leave, but if you've already committed, can I at least help you go where you want to go? Can I at least take you where you want to move? And she says, my son, that would be so kind. So they begin to walk. Have you guys ever walked with a very elder person? They have a lot of good deeds, mashallah, so they walk kind of slow, right? They have a lot of ajr and a lot of barak, a lot of good deeds, so they're weighed down a little bit, right? So like, what about bad deeds? No, we don't talk about bad deeds. Talk about good deeds, right? So they walk kind of slow. She's like the anti-Usain Bolt, right? And so they're walking. And when you walk slow, what goes up? The time you spend together, right? Right? Okay. Anyone? Physics? Anyone? No? Okay. Very good. So when you walk slowly, moving slow, time goes up. Is that physics? Am I making that up? Is that chemistry? I'm an English major. Okay. So, gotcha. Okay. So, bottom line, everyone gets what I'm saying. They're going very slowly. And she's talking what? She's talking a lot of trash, right? She's like, yeah, this man named Muhammad, he's stupid. I can't believe he's doing this. I heard this one story about him, that he did this. I heard his family doesn't even like him. I heard this, I heard that, I heard all this stuff. And he's listening to it. Have you guys ever been in a room where someone's talking about you and they don't know that you're there? That's super awkward, right? Or you walk in and they're inviting everyone else to the birthday party, you walk in, they're like, shh, shh, shh. Hey, Brother Murphy, right? That happens all the time when I'm doing like youth work. I walk into Roots, the room we have, the place we have, and they're like, yeah, we're going to go to the club. Hey, remember what's going on? Huh? Yeah. No, homework club, after school, high school. Right? I'm like, all right, guys, when you check in to the club on Facebook at 1 in the morning, I don't think you're doing homework, all right? Unless that new dance is called the homework, kind of like the Dougie. Anyways, so they're talking trash the whole time, right? She's talking a lot of trash about him. They get to a point, she's like, here, this is where I want to live. He's like, right here? She goes, right here. He begins to set up her tent for her. The whole time, she's talking trash. Right? Then, okay, he sets up her entire tent inside and outside. He cleans up the entire thing, does all the chores. This is like a 7-hour affair, right, from start to end. He looks at her and says, Ya Ummi, is everything to your liking? She says, my son, Ya Ibni, I couldn't have asked for anything more. He says, Ya Ummi. He says, then if you don't need anything else, do I have your permission to leave it? Look at how respectful he's being to her.
He doesn't even know her. She's talking mad trash, right? More trash than the garbage man, right? She's hating on him hardcore, and he has the patience to what? To say, can I have your permission to leave? She says yes. So yeah, I mean, you've done so much for me. I need, you know, please, like, you're more than welcome to go back and go into your day. I know you took out a bunch of time to help me. And he begins to walk away, and she says, my son, yeah, Ibni, 1 second. He says, what? She says, this whole time you've been doing work for me. You've been helping me out. You've been listening to me. You've been helping me. You haven't told me what your name is. And he says, I'm the Muhammad that you hate so much. And she began to cry. And she said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. That's transformation. That's internal. Right? That's internal. That's self-motivated. The Prophet didn't have to tell her, like, by the way, all that trash you were talking, that angel right here was writing all that down. Right? He didn't have to say that. He just gave her a little motivation. A little bit. But it was all self-motivated. He didn't have to command her to do anything. She did it on her own. So when we look at ourselves and we take that first step of looking in the mirror and seeing, what are my flaws? In the flip of the day, we said what? Write down 3 things on a piece of paper that you don't like about yourself. Go home and write this down. What are 3 things that I wish I didn't do? That I wish I didn't do. On the other side, write down 3 things that you love that you do. For example, let's say that you have a habit of fasting on the 13th, 14th, and 15th of every Islamic month, the 3 white days. Or let's say that you're really good to your parents. Like anything your parents ask, you do it, right? Or let's say that, mashallah, you help your brother or sister, respectively, right? Brothers like, yeah, all the sisters, right? Let's say you help your brother or sister, run away, quick, right? Let's say that someone needs help tutoring, someone needs help with, you know, orgo chem, because all of you are going to be doctors, right? Yeah. Okay. So you help them out. Or let's say that you get together once a month and you do Project Downtown, you go feed the needy in this area, the DMB area. Let's say you do something that you like, that you really, really, alhamdulillah, you thank Allah that He put that good inside of you, write that down on the other side. When we look in that mirror, we see what? We see things that we need to stop and things that we need to keep doing. And as we move on with our life, the purification of the nafs is what? More things leave this side of the page and enter this side of the page. Eventually, the negative side starts shortening and the positive side starts lengthening. And then eventually, on top of that, the negative side starts seeming smaller and smaller. So for example, if your negative before was that you never prayed Fajr, or you never prayed any prayer at all, or I never prayed, then our negative is, I wish I could pray Sunnah with my prayers. I need to start doing that. And then maybe it's, I wish I could wake up for Qiyam once a week, or twice a week, or 8 times a week, super religious person, right? All right? You see what I'm saying? That personal transformation has to be practical. Because a lot of people walk into this life and they walk out of this life constantly asking the question, how can I change myself? But no practical means are taken to fix the problems. Nothing. People ask, you know, one person asked me, how can I get this guy or girl out of my mind, right? There was a guy asking about a girl, but the question is both ways. I was in love with this girl, he said. I was crazy about her. I wanted to marry her. She wanted to marry me. And then all of a sudden, she didn't want to marry me, right? I think she saw Twilight, right? So she, I don't have an 8-pack. I'm no longer qualified, right? And he said, he's like, I mean, miskeen. He said, like, what? Like, I'm like, I feel terrible. Like, I can't get her on my mind, right? I can't. So first thing I asked, I said, what's your playlist, right? And the first song I think was like Taylor Swift's new song, right? We're never getting back together. But I kind of want to, right? But we're never doing it. Please? Okay, no, right? The first thing I told him was like, what are you letting enter your heart? If we're really going to be honest with ourselves about transforming ourselves, right? What are we going to transform? What's the object of transformation? Is the heart. That's what we want to revolt against, is the nafs that is controlling our heart. So what are we allowing enter? What are we allowing to enter into our heart? Through our ears, through our iPods, through our MP3s collection, and what are we allowing to enter through our eyes? I'm going to share a secret with you guys. You can't tell anyone, okay? You people watching this later on in the video, don't tell anyone. I watched the latest Twilight movie. I was drugged and forced into it, right? I woke up in the theater. What's going on? I just see like a giant werewolf. No, really, I watched it. I was really like. Basically I had family friends who wanted to go see it. It was kind of weird because they were like guests and they were like, well, I feel bad, people are going to start walking out. I'm like, Twilight, this guy's a phony, leave the lecture. No, I went and I saw it with them. Wallahi, I was shocked. First of all, the average age of women in that theater was like 46. Okay, that was number one. And when there's a scene where one of the male characters takes his shirt off, they all start screaming like a bunch of hyenas. It was scary. Thought I was in the freaking Lion King. I was getting attacked. But real talk though, we're sitting there, and I swear to you, there's a couple people that I went with, and they were Muslim. They're all Muslim, right? Everyone who I went with was Muslim. My wife and I went, and the whole time we were just like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. Looking down, I had to look down half the movie. There was like all this like haram stuff going on. I was like, yeah, bro. Sometimes I look to my left, and this is the serious part. Sometimes I look to my left, and I was sitting on the end of the right side, and there was a group of Muslim girls that I saw from the community, right? And I was like hiding myself because I don't want them to like run away. And there was a scene, there was a sex scene in that movie, and also the scene where the character takes off his shirt. And while I was looking away, they were like, dude, why are we laughing? That's poison. I know it's funny because like the face and all, but well, look, think about it. That's poison. That goes straight to the heart. There's no filter. There's no filtration process. That bypasses reality straight to the heart. So if we really want to if we want to take this seriously, really, if we're going to be real about this, I want to be a better person. Really, do you? Yeah, I do. Do I? I want to. Are we going to start taking the right steps and being practical about it? There was a group of friends who wanted to go see another movie. They asked me, like, do you want to go see this movie? I said, let's go check out this website. It's called kidsinmind.com. Check it out. It's run by this Christian organization. They're kind of weird, but they rate it based on, not because they're Christian, but because they're like Netflinders. They base it on sexuality, violence, and profanity. Check the sexuality and profanity ratings. Violence, also, we shouldn't be accustomed to seeing, but check those two mainly. They wanted to go see a movie. The rating for sexuality was an 8. 10 is the highest. Let's go see it. I was like, no thanks. And they describe, by the way, in text, all of the scenes that are sexually being shown. If we want to take this seriously, brothers and sisters, we're going to have to start really protecting our heart. This thing is more valuable than diamonds. This thing is more valuable than any precious stone on this earth. This piece of flesh right here is the most precious thing that you own. The most precious thing that I own. How much would we protect a diamond if we found it versus our heart? We would never let a piece of gold roll around in the dirt, but we let our heart roll around in the filth of sexuality and of profanity. We gotta be very careful, right? So be very careful what enters the eyes and the ears, because that goes straight to the heart. And the focus of that is why? Because it's good for us to abstain from those things. How do we do it? How do we do it? I'm not trying to make anyone feel bad. Everyone in this room, particularly the person, the big white guy sitting at this table, needs transformation. Everyone does. It's a constant thing. It's a constant thing, right? So I'm not talking down to anyone. I'm actually speaking as a servant to you all, offering some advice. How do we do it then? The first thing, I want everyone who has a piece of paper to write this down. And if you don't, then maybe type it on your phone in your notes. The first step to transformation, like we said, is get over the denial. We all need it. The minute that you or I think that we're good, that's the moment that we need it most. The second step to getting through this transformation process and starting it, kickstarting it, getting it running is, like I said, be practical and write a list of things that you want to change about yourself. Keep a journal. Keep a diary. Brothers, keep a journal. Sisters, keep a diary. Same thing, different words, right? Keep a written record of things that you want to change and of things that you want to keep, the things that you want to improve. The third step is to assess and evaluate your lifestyle. Look at your iPhone. What's in the music app? Look at your iTunes library. Look at your Blu-ray or DVD collection. Or for those of you who are more tech savvy and illegal, your torrent collection, right? Look at your collection of AV, audiovisual, your media. Look at all that and see what are the things that are penetrating into my soul, right, that are changing my perspective. I'm not even kidding with y'all. Like, I've met guys who are like, I will not marry a girl unless she looks like Kim Kardashian. First question, why do you know what Kim Kardashian looks like? Second, hopefully you don't know too much about what Kim Kardashian looks like. And third is, do you recognize how that image of plastic and makeup has penetrated your heart? You realize how that's changed your reality, right? So be aware of that. The fourth thing is look at your friend circle. Look at your company. Do y'all influence each other? Y'all is a Southern thing, by the way. Sorry. It's like a plague. I grew up in Chicago, and I moved to Dallas, then I moved to Knoxville, Tennessee. The minute you hear y'all, you have to resist it as much as possible. But the minute you say it, it's like a drug. You can't let go, right? It's just so easy. You can say you all, but y'all is so much quicker. Okay, so y'all, the minute that y'all check out your friend circle and see who affects you in a good way and in a bad way, that's when you start knowing that you're taking this seriously. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean that we look at our friends who maybe influence us in a negative way and we're like, suck for a lot, Shaitan. See you later, right? No, we don't do that. You know, some people and some teachers and some scholars might say, yeah, do it. Just cut them off. I've actually heard this. I've actually heard some speakers say, just cut them off. I don't agree with that. Because the Prophet, people used to come to him and he used to talk to everyone. And those people weren't as good as him. Right? By the way, a little caveat here, never, ever, ever think that you're better than anyone. Everyone has different strengths and weaknesses, and the cumulative score of those strengths and weaknesses are only known by Allah. Everyone has strengths and weaknesses, and the total score of all that, only known by Allah. None of us know. So all of you might think that I'm Brother Murphy, I'm so pious, sitting up here giving a talk, but all of my weaknesses might take me lower than anyone else in this room. Some of you might see a sister who doesn't wear hijab, and you think that that's like a super strong weakness, but all of her positives bring her above everyone else in this room. Only Allah knows those things. How do we play it safe? We treat everyone as if they're better than us. But in practical terms, when we're looking at our friend circle, we see the actions of what people do, and we see the advice that we give. If you're sitting with a group of friends, and there are people who just do not stop backbiting, and just pull everyone in, right? Then that's something you have to evaluate, and maybe you need to have a conversation. If you're sitting with a group of friends, and they always influence you to go somewhere else, to a place that's not good, then you need to check that. By the way, a little tip on finding good friends. A lot of people ask me, how do I find good friends? Be the friend that you want to have. If you're a great friend, then great friends will come out of your friend circle. If you're a great person and you do good, you have good hobbies and habits and good character, then your friend circle will instantly raise. If all of your friends do that, then you will be elevated. You will see the barakah fall into your group of friends. But if someone is like, man, I backbite, I look at this, I do that, and they complain about their friends doing the same thing, it's because water finds its own level. You have to raise the level, and then everyone else will raise as well, right? So it's very important to realize that transformation is a very practical process. It's not a spiritual, mystical thing, although there is a lot of spirituality to it. It's very practical, and we have to look at it as such. I know that we don't have a lot of time left, but I do know that people love question and answer, and I think that this can get more of a penetrating kind of discussion going. And so this is the introduction that I gave, inshallah, and I thank all of you for inviting me here. If anyone wants to ask me questions, I thoroughly and really appreciate questions after sessions, like right now in the open. And I appreciate them quickly because what happens is for the first 10 minutes, we all kind of look around at each other for a little bit. And then at the end, I have to like cut off like 20 people's questions and say, sorry, we can't do it, right? So if you have a question, then feel free, inshallah, raise your hand and ask.
Tyler, give me one moment. We're just going to make a couple quick announcements, and then we can do the Q&A.
Okay.
Basically, there's a flyer in Burke. They're opening up a new masjid on January 11th. Ustad Muhammad El Shanawi, he's going to be given the lecture there. But we do want to show support to that new masjid in Burke. Also, guys, we're selling our shirts and sweatshirts. And on the back of the shirts, it says 2012. So let's buy them before 2012 ends, so you can be part of the era.
Are they on sale in 2013?
You know, they're already on sale. So the short sleeve are $8, the long sleeve are $10, and then we have our brand new sweatshirts we just got made this week.
Guys, all right.
Bringing Islam to you.
Oh,
snap.
Sharia law.
And then also, gmumsa@googlegroups.com. So if you guys ever have any questions or need anything from us, you can email the officers there. Our website, gmumsa.onmason.com. And then we're also on Twitter and Facebook. Let me see what else I have here. If you're not getting the MSA emails, there's laptops in the back. Just make sure you give us your email. We send out our weekly announcements there. Also, support Syria right now. The massacre going on there. It's just heart-wrenching. Some of the videos, I can't even watch them. But we're working with Islamic Relief to raise funds, and they're helping out Syria. So in the back, you can make donations. We take cash or credit card. Technology, swipe the card right up here, so it makes it very easy. And then I think that's all the announcements I have right now. So if you guys need a mic, I'll come around with the mic for questions. If not, just raise your hand.
I have a side note real quick on Syria. A lot of us have the question of what we can do to help? A lot of us? I think everyone does. Like, besides donation, when you give a donation, you feel great, but you feel like you want to do something every day. This transformation is part of that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that He will not change the condition of a people until they themselves change their own condition. So if we're talking about the Muslim Ummah and we're tired of being the victim, we're tired of being beaten up and killed all over in Palestine and Burma and Ethiopia and Somalia and Syria, if you're tired of it, then take that tired energy and transform it into better actions. The more that we all grow as a community, the more protected that we'll find ourselves and the more beneficial that we'll see. All right, that's something active. That's something that really is going to test and see who really wants to help Syria. Okay.
I have this friend who actually, he smokes and he drinks, mm-hmm. like alcohol, but I was trying to get gala to him, but now he never encourages me to smoke with him or drink with him or anything.
Okay.
But I'm trying to help him.
Yeah, so the question that you have generally is like, would you consider someone a good friend or bad friend, and how would you help them if you see them? We don't put people in boxes, because that's not how life works. Like, people don't fit into boxes. I'm not saying you made a mistake, I'm just saying this is something that I used to do when I was younger. I used to be like, hypocrite, believer, gaffer, don't know yet, right? Come back, TBA, right? I used to have this problem when I was a younger person. I think a lot of young, religiously, religious zealots, honestly, kind of have this issue where, like, we just love labeling people. Like, we just love it. Like, we're just like, yeah, because it gives us comfort that we know what someone is, right? When in reality, the most comfortable thing is leaving it all up to Allah. Allah knows the quality of someone's belief, the quality of someone's action. He knows it. He knows it. And the more that we worry about it, the more that we're going to stress ourselves out, and we'll never, ever be satiated. Now, practically speaking, though, we have to make a distinction between actions that are good and actions that are bad. We never attribute the action quality to the person. If someone steals something, we're not going to say that they are a perpetual thief. We'll say that they are a person who made a mistake and stole something. If someone commits zina or drinks alcohol or smokes, then they are not a sinner, a terrible person, but they happen to make that mistake or do that thing once or twice or whatever, right? So the concept of how do you help someone? The Prophet ﷺ teaches us this time and time again. You know, the Prophet very rarely, ﷺ, very rarely did he engage in verbal debate. Very rarely. You can probably count under 10 times that he engaged in a solid verbal discussion. And those verbal discussions only took place after that person had known him for a long time and had seen his character. Right? Why was the Prophet ﷺ so effective as a person? Because for 40 years, he was known as As-Sadiq Al-Amin. For 40 years. Is anyone 40 in this room? Anyone? Right? No. Okay, I want to make sure before. No one's hand is up, correct? No one here has even lived that long. Right? So the real answer to doing da'wah to people is just be the da'wah that you want to see. Be the da'wah that you want to see. And eventually they'll come to you, right? They'll see something inside of you that they appreciate, that they like, that they find peaceful. They'll come to you and they'll ask. And if they don't, that's fine. Nothing is supposed to be pushed on anyone, right? But when we act a certain way and talk a certain way, especially in a very preachy way, it turns people off. I used to live in Dallas, Texas. Alhamdulillah, now I live in Knoxville, Tennessee. But I used to live in Dallas, Texas.
And I was a youth director at a masjid there. And I don't usually wear thobes and stuff, like the Arab like prom man prom dress. but I have like a healthy collection of them. I don't usually wear them. But sometimes I do, because it's important to respect, like, you know, it is a very modest clothing, it's a very modest garment. And I do like wearing thiyab sometimes, like thobes. But normally I just wear normal like clothes. And so I happened to be wearing a thobe when I went to Kroger. You guys have Kroger here? It's a grocery store. It's like a...
It's like our Giant.
Yeah, it's like a Giant or a Wegmans. I went to Giant last night. It's not like Giant. It's a little bit... Giant's like... Kroger's like... All right, okay. So anyways, it's kind of like Wegmans, right? A little bit like Whole Foods. And I went there to... My wife was out of town, so I went to go buy dinner. So I had my box of cereal. And I went, and I took it, and I put... I can cook. Just real talk, I can cook. So I put my Honey Bunches of Oats on the conveyor belt. I'm wearing a thobe. It's a very Muslim populous area. And so even though I'm wearing a thobe, everyone knows, like, okay, he's wearing that Muslim thing, right? I have a beard, I'm wearing a kufi. And I go up to the lady, and my dad has this habit of asking people, like, everyone that he sees, like, how are you? Whenever he's buying something, how's your day going? So as a kid, I learned that from him. And so when I went up to the counter, I said, hi, good evening, how are you, right? I was not expecting this response. She goes, oh my God. I go, what? My sister in the back was sleeping, sorry about that. Goes, oh my God. I go, what? She goes, I've been waiting for someone to ask me about my day the whole day. I was like, I want Honey Bunches of Oats more than anything right now. And you are in between me and my HBO, right? And she just starts like telling me about how like her boyfriend broke up with her that day. Her car had a flat tire. I think her cat had like some sort of infection or something. Like just like all the worst things ever. And I'm just like, oh my God, my milk's gonna go turn to yogurt. Like, and she goes, no, at the end of it, she goes, thank you so much. You don't know how good I feel just getting that off my chest. Exactly. I had nothing to do with it. All I did was just ask her how her day was, and it wasn't even sincere. It was just like a typical like conversation starter. But she ended up, and who knows, maybe now she'll see, well, that Muslim guy actually, because no, she said no one else asked her the whole day how her day was. So maybe now she'll think, oh, that Muslim guy asked me how my day was. That was really nice of him to listen. That's the way that Muslims in America or any non-majority Muslim country, that's the way that we do dawah. We don't go and say, like, by the way, this prophet was an amazing guy. He did this. And they're like, well, what about you, right? We need to make sure that we turn into the prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We become like him, right? If we be like Muhammad, then people won't even have to ask who he is anymore. They'll see it. Very good question, though.
I just have a question about having, like, best friends, whatever, around. I think we can just keep them because it depends on how much level of iman you have. Mm.
Yeah, jazakallah khair. I think that that's a personal decision. Like, again, I'm not trying to create a black and white formula that everyone has to follow. I'm just saying be aware of these things. Like, if we really want to become better people, then we have to make sure that we are with people that make us better, right? And that doesn't mean that that person is no longer qualified. Like, if there's a friend of mine, listen, I have friends who smoke, I have friends who drink alcohol, Muslim friends who drink. I have them. But when they're around me, do they drink? No. When they're around me, do they talk about it? No. They know they can't. When they're around me, they're with the group. You know what I'm saying? They kind of follow along. If we're all going to go pray, none of them are like, I don't want to pray. They go pray, right? But we have to check and see if our friends are pulling us to places that we don't belong to, right? If that's the case, then we have to not cut them off. I'm not saying defriend them on Facebook, which is like the ultimate like friendship ending movement or anything, right? Don't defriend them on Facebook. Like, if you really want to let someone know that you're not friends anymore, just do it there, and they'll know, right? How come it says add friend? Okay. Don't defriend them completely. Just make sure that you, whenever an obstacle to your faith comes up, like a bad habit or something, don't show any interest in it. There's a lot of people, man, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to express something that you think is not right.
right? If they're really your friends, they won't bother. Don't do it in a bad way. But if they're like, yeah, we're going to go to the club tonight, I'd be like, man, I wouldn't go if I were you, but, you know. And again, it's your call, right? If you say it that way, then they're like, I swear to you, I've said this to people, and they're like, you're right, man, you're so right. I'm trying to get out of this lifestyle. Like, they realize it. We realize it. When we make mistakes, when someone comes to me and says, Brother Murphy, like, you shouldn't have said something like that. I know, and I realize it, right? And I'm working on that. But if someone just cut me off completely, I would never even have a pathway to become better. And it's because of the people around me that I even became, I'm not good, but I even became the low amount of benefit that I am today. I mean, a lot of you don't know, but like in high school, I wasn't Muslim. I grew up Muslim and then I left Islam for 4 years. I didn't live at home. Like, I lived it up in a bad way. I did whatever I wanted to. And if my friends, my Muslim friends and my siblings had just cut me off, like a lot of people do, then I wouldn't be here in front of you today. I wouldn't even be next to you. Who knows where I'd be? But because of those friends who they kept in touch, they didn't go with me to the club, they didn't go with me to the, you know, bar or whatever, but they kept in touch with me. Not that I went, I'm just saying, giving examples. Everyone's like, fatwa alert, right? But they kept in touch with me. Because of that, the rope was still good. I could still pull myself back, right? But don't cut the rope. But thank you, Jazakallah Khair. It's very good. You have to also gauge it yourself. As she's saying, you have to be kind of gauge yourself. Are they really pulling you down, or can you maintain a level or grow with them, inshallah? Jazakallah Khair.
Any other questions? Just raise your hand. I'll bring the microphone.
Yeah, at the back. Thanks to the brothers who, by the way, decorated this with flowers and... Well, I know, I'm just joking. They were like, sisters? Yeah, no, I'm just joking around. I know what it was. Yes, sister.
Okay, so I just wanted to comment on one of the claims you made about Twilight and how that was like poisoning to your heart.
How about, wait, hold on, 1 second. Twilight and what?
How like those things are a poison to your heart.
So yeah.
I think that's a questionable claim because, like, at a young age, that's not that. That's more due to like biological, like, and neurological reasons, like, and hormonal reasons, and like it's more of a okay. Like, if we all isolated ourselves from all those outside factors, that still wouldn't limit our imagination. And imagination's more powerful than all those. And mm-hmm. imagination like sparks from your own mind and has nothing to do with whatever you saw. Like, you could create new images in your imagination, and that would provide that satisfaction that you wouldn't be getting if you did not watch any, if you did not expose yourself to the outside world. Mm-hmm. So I think that's like pretty, I think that...
Basically, you just think I'm wrong. It's okay, you can say it.
No, I just think that it's like,
okay.
Everyone's, because we should say that it's, like, I think it's pretty harmless because we should be saying that because everyone has free will, you can control your thoughts and mm-hmm. you can control how you react to whatever you see.
Okay.
So it's better to say that, to counter it by saying that you have free will and that even though you are watching that and you know it's wrong, but you pointed out, it's better to make that distinction. And, but yeah, you can't completely isolate yourself from
society.
The modern world. So.
Yeah. No, for sure. Jazakallah Khair. Thank you. So I agree with that to a certain degree. I went and saw it, right? So like, I'm not saying that like you have to like live in a cave, unless you're Batman, then it'd be sweet. by the way, you know what the first night of Ramadan was? It was also the release for Dark Knight Rises. Do you know what I do with my youth group? I took 45 kids to go see Dark Knight Rises on the first night of Ramadan at midnight. Then we went and prayed to Qiyam al-Layl to make Toba for that. Then we went to Waffle House to eat our feelings, right? And then we fasted. So I'm not like your typical, I won't be like your typical like Imam Saab who's gonna be like haram, haram, haram. But I'm just saying, let's be honest with ourselves. Let me explain what I mean. It shapes, you mentioned imagination, and you mentioned how like free will, we have the decision to choose, we can block things out. The danger behind things like this, sister, listening and watching, is that it shapes people's reality. It shapes, and there is scientific data behind this. Men who watch pornography, right? Men who actively look at pornography, when they engage in relations with their significant other, hopefully their spouse, they expect it to be like the pornography they're watching, when pornographic films are nothing like intimacy between marital couples. So things that we watch affect the reality that we then perceive. Let me give you an example. The Prophet ﷺ, when he married Aisha, how old was she? Some say 9, some say 14, some say 7. Generally speaking, it's younger than any age we would consider to be normal in this country, correct? That's correct, right? It's a social construct that they followed in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. It's not something that we would follow in America, although today in other countries it is followed. How old was, what's her name, that little baby thing from Twilight? Renesmee. How old was Renesmee when Jacob fell in love with her? So there's a character in the movie who's like, how old is Jacob, like 18? 20? He's a 20-year-old half-wolf, half-man. And he is romantically in love. He has imprinted his love onto this child. And he verbalizes it, and it makes the mother very uncomfortable. My point being is that whenever anyone hears about the Prophet marrying Aisha at such a young age, it's such a weird thing. Oh my God, how could he do that? He's a child molester, or either they say these things. But then when Jacob's in love with this baby, they're all like, oh. That's creepy. No, that's creepy. Let's be honest. Can we be honest? That's creepy. If you saw a man walk in here and he's like, I'm in love with a toddler, what would you say? Sandusky, very good. You would be disgusted. I would be disgusted. But because the movie has been formed in a way that is palatable, because it's in the context of a story that people have already taken in, they're already addicted to, then it becomes normal. Right? And I'm not saying that if a man was in love with a baby, it'd be normal. What I'm saying is, why was there no reaction? Why was there no reaction? Why, when they were like, you're in love with my child, why wasn't everyone like, ew? Instead, they were like, oh, that's so awesome. Why? Because movies and music can shape our reality. Is it not true that the music you listen to can change your mood? I'm just saying. Again, am I saying Twilight is haram? I can't pass fatwa. I'm not a mufti. Right? I'm not. Right? I'm just a dude. But I'm a dufti. I'm not a mufti. But I will say this. I don't think it's healthy. I don't think it's healthy. When I walked out of that theater, I felt bothered. And I'm not like the most religious of people. I'm just saying I felt bothered. I felt weirded out that, you know, there was so much questionable material in it. But again, I took all my youth to go watch Dark Knight Rises. And there's questionable material in that. I like covered all their eyes. I was like a mother. I was like, so it's. But I appreciate you disagreeing with me, and I think that we can all take a lesson. What's your name, sister?
Wait, you guys counter that also.
Let's go ahead, counter it. This is interesting. Yeah, just give her 1 minute. Yeah, like Maslow's hierarchy, yeah. True, but my argument is that you are... So she was saying, just real quick, just for everyone, she was saying that basically, regardless of whether or not you watch it, your imagination is going to compensate. You're going to reach that point either way, so whether or not you watch it, the damage is already done. Or not the damage, the point is already reached. My counter-argument would be that why do some people have weird imaginations? Why do we consider some people to have weird thoughts and some that are very normative? And why would we encourage them to have these thoughts that are not normal, right? I don't think anyone would have come up naturally to say that this is normal, right? And why does it affect the way that they think afterwards, right? Like, why does pornography affect the way that men think after they watch it? We can talk later, just you and I, inshallah. Like, we can be emailed, because I think we have questions. But I appreciate you disagreeing with me. I think that's awesome. I think that's really cool.
There's just one more counter to that counter.
Yeah. I agree with what she's saying in that, yeah, we have desires, but I disagree. Like, yeah, we have desires doesn't mean we're gonna go watch porn because the desires are there anyway. The porn or whatever will increase that. So yeah, we have desires, but to a certain extent.
Yeah, so. I agree. I don't think she was, by the way, just to defend the sister, I don't think she was advocating watching haram things. No, seriously, I don't think she was. I just think she was just trying to say that it's not as clear cut as I made it. I disagree. But again, this is part of the beauty of...
One of the questions from the brothers. From your experience as a youth director, what is the best advice you can give to how we can give dawah to the youth or other youth?
I think just be that person. Like, no one likes to be told. By the way, have you all made mistakes before in your life?
Yeah.
Were you all aware that there was a mistake when you were making it?
Yeah.
Usually we are, right? It's like, not like, really, missing fudgers a sin? Word? Oh, right? Then life has changed. No, most of us are aware of the mistakes we make as we're making them, for sure. So number one, when we're talking to youth, quote unquote, you don't have to highlight the mistakes that they're making and say, you're doing this wrong. Like, that's, everyone knows. We all know, right? It's about becoming a good example for them, becoming a good friend, a good companion, a good example. The Prophet ﷺ was a lot of things. One of the things he was a great friend, excellent friend. He always influenced people in a proper way, and he was magnetic in that sense. So just work on becoming magnetic and a good influence. You don't have to preach all the time. In fact, please don't preach. Like, preaching is very easy. Being a good friend is very difficult. Can I tell you something? Can I tell you guys a secret? No? Everyone's kind of uncomfortable. Like, well, we don't know you that well. On Wednesday, before I came here, I had a friend that I had to, well, a friend, but he's a person from my youth, you know, like the group that we have in Tennessee. I had to bail him out of jail, right? Because he had some warrant for something. And he was shocked. Well, also, I called him yesterday. He was shocked that I was even still talking to him, because he thought that what he had done was so heinous that no one was going to talk to him anymore. And just reaching out to him, again, I'm not saying that I'm an amazing person. I didn't expect his response. But just reaching out to him on the phone, like, he started crying. And he wants to pick me up from the airport tomorrow when I go home, and he just wants to hang out the whole day with me. Because I'm cool as heck. Right? No, because he really thought that, like, he just thought that he was off my list for the rest of his life. Like, he was like, there's no way. Right? And I'm like, what are you talking about? Let's go hang out tomorrow. And he's like, for real? I was like, yeah, pick me up. He's like, nice. And he was like crying. And so, like, just be there for people, man. Just serve people. Like, we don't have to tell them. We don't have to talk to them. Just be there for them. Inshallah.
Anybody else? Question?
Go ahead. So I completely agree with you that you definitely should be the example that you want to see. And you should lead by example. I think it's like 110% correct. But in the case where you are in debate or discussion, how would you not come off preachy and just want to be informative, but not necessarily come off pushy? I know it's kind of a fine line of a gray area.
Yeah.
It's something that I kind of look into sometimes.
Gotcha.
But I always get it that I'm almost kind of being a little bit too pushy.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I've really been trying to work on that. And it's something that I've always found to be very challenging. So, any piece of advice? I mean, of course, you would want to be that example, but in the case that you would be in a discussion, how would you not want to push?
Because discussions are inevitable, right? Even the Prophet says, I'm engaged in discussion, right? So the brother is saying that, yeah, being an example, that's great. That's gonna work like majority of the time. But there are times, definitely, that happen where we do have to engage in a debate or discussion. Number one, I would say, is try your best, absolutely, not to be condescending at all, in the least. Condescending meaning that you put them down. That's never going to help any cause. And what happens is that when you do that, people instantly become defensive, and they never want to listen to anything that you say. They'll forget the content, and they'll just focus on you and how condescending I'm being or you're being to them. So number one is don't be condescending. Number two is never take the debate too far. Like, at some point, when you find out that you're running in circles, you just have to stop. Right? At some point, the information is within them, and they will come to trust it or agree with it when the time is right. You're going to talk to them as much as you want. I mean, this happens with family members all the time. You're trying to tell your parents something, they disagree. Trying to tell them something, they disagree. After a while, how many times are you going to tell them? How many times can you keep repeating the same thing over and over and over again? You can't. Sometimes you just have to say, like, all right, I guess we just disagree. And that actually stepping away from an argument can be the most convincing thing that you can do. I've had so many people that when I've had a discussion with them, again, particularly youth, they're trying to ask me one kid was like, why is marijuana haram, right? It was a serious question. And we had a discussion, and after a while, we started talking back and forth, and he was just repeating the same things, like, dude, where's my car? And I was repeating the other same things over and over again, right? And eventually, I was like, okay, you know what? It's definitely not okay, but
you know, you are your own person, so you make your own decisions. Like 2 days later, he was like, you're right. It's not all. I'm like, he just came back. He was like, you're right. Sometimes stepping away is the proper thing. But you know what? At the end of the day, when you do all these things, you're not condescending. You're very, very proper when you speak. You're polite. Sometimes you step away when you have to. Sometimes you're just not going to win it. And that's why the Prophet said what? He promises a house in the middle of Jannah for who? For the one who backs away from the discussion, even if they're right, he said. Even if they're right. Because he was telling you, he's like, by the way, you're going to be right sometimes, but you're just going to have to back away. Right? So take those steps. If it doesn't work, it's okay. We all at one point in our life were really strong on something and then came to realize that we weren't right. So let that happen for other people too.
Mike, or you want to just...
I can just talk. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So I have this friend of mine, and we were really close, and then a couple weeks ago she told me that she completely gave up on Islam, and she was Muslim. Mm-hmm. So I tried to be like, help her and stuff like that, and then she would pull out random things in the Quran and be like, how is this possible, stuff like that. Mm. So I just tried to be her motivation in a sense, and then out of her own will, I tried to convince her to go see my mom and maybe get some help. Mm. But after that, she just didn't want to see him. She didn't want to talk about Islam and everything like that. So I didn't know what I should do, so I slowly just started distancing myself away from her. Mm. But then again, she moved away from this area, so she doesn't really have a support system, like a good Muslim community. Mm. And her parents don't really know what she's going through, so I felt like I was her only like link to bring her back, mm-hmm. in a sense. So how do I like foster that relationship again, or what do you think I should do in that sense?
So like, I don't know about you guys, but when I'm with my friends, we don't always talk about Islam. We talk about a lot of things. And so I think that's a common, between a good friend or two good friends, that there's more in common to you than your faith. And that's why you can have non-Muslims who are friends. I play golf with this pastor in Knoxville every week. And Pastor Tyler, I'm white, I play golf, I know, right? And he's not Muslim, I'm not Christian, but we have things in common that we talk about. And so to answer your immediate question of how do I foster the relationship with someone who I'm losing similarities with, faith being the biggest one, just focus on things that are outside of that realm. Now, when we talk about someone losing their iman, right, or losing their faith, more often than not, in my situation, I can tell you that it was frustration, it wasn't disbelief. When I dipped out of the community for like a few years in high school, it had nothing to do with me finding any contradictions in the Quran. Although, when I became frustrated with the community, with my family, erroneously, I tried to find contradictions in the Quran, and I made up like contradictions. Like, how could Islam teach this and this and this? So a lot of people project a false sense of disbelief that's contradictory in nature, but in reality, it's just trauma. There's some sort of annoyance or frustration or traumatic event that pushed them over the edge, right? That's how it was with me, and that's a lot of people that I met who left Islam, my oldest sister being one of them as well, but she still actually is Christian. That was the case. So when you talk to people who say, I don't believe anymore, this and that, a lot of it just has to do with that kind of reality. The important thing for them is to keep talking to them about their problems, keep talking them through it as long as they want to. But the most important thing is to be there for them if and when they come back. Because a lot of Islam is so naturally inclinable, right? Is that a word? I don't know. It's so naturally attractive and magnetic that people have a hard time. I remember during my leave of absence that I remember being like, I know I'm going to go back. I knew it because it's just so magnetic. Like, it makes so much sense, right? If I went back and no one was there to greet me, then I would have been like, man, I knew I should have come back. So the biggest thing is to be there, arms open, to accept the person when they come back, and just make sure you maintain that relationship with things that maybe you don't have in that you have in common that aren't necessarily Islam. So, but it's tough, and I mean, like, suggesting you go to an imam, that's a big deal. That's a big deal, and I think that's a good idea. But a lot of people just need some space for a little bit. It's tough. I'd be more than happy to help out if you need anything.
Faria, if you want to go ahead and just wherever.
Try looking at the bottom of the switch.
Just talking to her.
Can you hear?
I'll just bring you my mic.
Probably gonna have to use the F word. No, I'm kidding. now you know what? Like I've come. Where are you from, sister? Where did you guys? Where are the students from?
Actually, we are diverse from the Gulf countries. Some of us from United States, and some of us from Saudi Arabia, and some of us.
Okay.
Wait. So Arabic speakers.
Yeah. Okay. So like one of the issues that I'm seeing is that, and this lends itself back to the Twilight question that we were talking about, is that one of the guys that, this is a story that kind of relates to this. So one of the people that I was talking to recently that started drinking alcohol, he's a Muslim and he was drinking with his friends in college. He was a foreign student, not exchange student, but a foreign student from another country, from the subcontinent. And he said, thank you, probably read my mind. He said that if he didn't raise glasses and drink with his classmates, that they wouldn't look at him the same. I went to college here. And I graduated, and I had a lot of classmates who used to drink, and I'm about as American as I can get. Like, I love apple pie, I play golf, like, I'm just very American. And I never drank alcohol in college with my classmates. Hi.
I'm just testing it back here, sorry.
Okay, I was like,
sorry.
I was like, am I lying? He's like, hello. And, the point of the story is that a lot of them feel a social pressure to fit in, but what's ironic is that that pressure is exaggerated and magnified by the movies that we watch and the television that we see, you know, and the music that we listen to. The lifestyle that we try to live, right, is oftentimes influenced by those things in the media. The answer to your question is that oftentimes there's not one thing that you can just say. And I struggle with this a lot. People come to me for answers, and I always try to find the perfect answer to convince them. And you know what? Sometimes you can't. You know, like, sometimes you just have to give them the advice and then let them live. You know, at some point, we cannot change everyone, and my perspective on this has changed drastically. When I used to give someone advice and they wouldn't take it, I would become depressed, I'd become very sad, and I would just see them. But now I'm realizing that people sometimes, you give them advice, and it takes them a couple months just to understand what you meant. The brother who was drinking and who told me that I have to drink, otherwise my, I have, he didn't even say drink, like he even said raise glasses in a fobby way. He's like, raise glasses. I was like, you don't raise, no one raises glasses at a bar, dude. No one's like, yeah, America. Like no one does that, right? They just like pound the Jaeger and just go. You know, the guy who I was telling, when I told him at the end of it, I said, you know, you, and I told him, I was like, you need to realize that this is not what all Americans, they don't disrespect you if you don't drink. He just wouldn't listen to it. But you know what? I have a feeling in a couple months, like, he'll come back. I have a feeling. Just be there for them when they come back. And just keep kind of giving them a little bit of advice each time. When they say it, be like, no, it's not proper. You know, using that language is not proper. It's not good. Yeah?
Basically, when I'm there, we will not say this word.
Got you.
But when I go to the Twitter or...
Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah. So here's another thing, by the way. This is not just international students. This is everyone. Is that people are not the same on the internet as they are in real life. It's like internet personality disorder, right? IBD. No, seriously, how many of you have ever encountered someone who's different on the internet than they are in real life?
Wow.
We all have. I mean, come on, everyone has.
Oh, it's an iPhone. How's it going?
I wanted to ask, now, as human beings, we're mukallafin, right?
Mm-hmm.
So where do you draw the line between birr al-walidain and the taqid that you're supposed to be able to do that will make a transformation, a true transformation?
Birr al-walidain and?
Even if your parents don't agree to what you want to do,
yeah.
And even if it takes you toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
yeah.
Where, then birr al-walidain?
No. Okay, so basically the question is, if you have something that you want to do, a project or something that you're involved with, or a certain lifestyle that you want that's better for you, that will take you closer to Allah, but your parents feel maybe uncomfortable with it, where's the line that we draw? Because you have to be obedient to your parents and be good to your parents, but at the same time, if you are obedient in this case, then it might take you away from something that's taking closer to Allah. Where's the line? I'm not a parent, but I was a child, right? I was a kid. And I remember growing up, and I remember having certain things that my mom would say don't go to, and certain things my mom would say do. I would have certain things that my mom would encourage me to, you know, certain friends that she would encourage me to stay away from, certain friends, you know, all the typical being raised universally, parents will just try to tell you things, different things. You have to gauge what they're saying and how they're saying it. There's a difference between, hey, mom, can I go here? I don't know. There's a difference between that and can I go? No. Huge difference, right? So the problem is, a lot of times, when we hear the definitive no, we still try to push back. You have to sometimes give some battles up, and then sometimes take some on your own. If your parents are very against certain things that you do, then you have to be able to discuss and tell them and talk to them. If they still come to no, then you should try to be obedient to them in that moment. But if it's a trend where they're constantly holding you back from every single thing, and there's no reason, and you get your uncles and aunts and you get their advice and they say, no, there's no reason why you should be held back. You go to the imam and they say, no, there's no reason why. You go to all the family, you ask for some nasiha and they say, no, there's no reason why. Then you need to get your parents kind of involved in like an intervention, right? A lot of it has to do with you getting people involved that can convince them. But if you try to go one-on-one, you're always gonna lose that battle. You're always gonna lose. Now, if your uncles and aunts are like, no, listen, this might not be good for you, especially aunts and uncles that you're close with, then take their advice and just trust them, right? But at the end of the day, this is part of the struggle of growing up. You know, their parents did it to them, our parents do it to us. I'm not gonna say that you can disobey your parents. Everyone's like, dang, right? But I will say this, that there are ways that you can win them over. And there are ways that, you, even if they say that they're not completely happy with it, that's still not a no, right? So you gotta choose to pick your battles wisely, get people involved, like your uncles and aunts and imams and respected people. At the end of the day, you have to make a decision. I would not disobey if I were you. Allahu a'lam. It's tough, I know.
For you, if you want to go to the orange. Oh, you had a question there? Go ahead.
I had a question about getting judged. I know culturally, like Middle Eastern, like being in that Middle Eastern culture, we've been taught to judge everyone. And how do you deal with people judging you, like, just being able to, you know, communicate to them in a peaceful way without getting, you know, so emotional. Because initially you're very emotional when someone judges you. You just want to attack. But how do you deal with that?
You know, it really depends on your relationship with the person. One thing I will say that I always, whenever you're trying to emotionally de-escalate a situation, a very good way to do that is through email. It's through text messaging, but I would prefer email. Some sort of non-verbal communication, because you can clear your thoughts out and you can write what needs to be written instead of saying things, because when you say words, you can't take them back. But when you write, you can delete and rephrase and change. You can save it in the folder and then send it tomorrow. There's a lot of different alterations you can do. Gmail even has an undo button, so if you send it too quick, you can undo and delete that last line. But there's a lot of things that you can do. So if you're having the problem of being judged, with a single person or a group of people, I would reach out to them via one of these ways, right? You can write a letter, email, etc. If it happens like across an entire community, then you may have to be a little more verbal about it and tell them directly, like, I don't like it when you say this about me. Just be very straightforward. A lot of us, I think we undermine the power of just being straightforward with people, not yelling, not screaming, but just saying it. You know, do you guys know what Sam Cannon is? Any idea what Sam Cannon is? Wow, he's super West Coast, I guess. Okay. So Osama Cannon is like a speaker, a teacher, a sheikh from the West Coast, and he used to do prison dawah. He used to go to the chaplains, or he used to be a chaplain at a prison. And one, his name was Osama. One time he walked into the prison, and he had a bag of books, because he used to go teach the Muslim prisoners, and one of the guards was like, "Hey Osama, what is that, a bomb?" Right? Again, that's judgment, right? And he looked straight, and everyone's like laughing, like, ha ha ha. He looked straight in the guard's eyes, deep in his soul, and he says, "That wasn't funny." And the guy says, "I'm sorry," and starts crying. Right? He starts crying. The next week, because he used to go on a weekly basis, the next week he walks in with his bag, and the guard gives him a plate of cookies. We undermine sometimes the power of just telling someone something. So if you know someone's talking trash or talking smack about you, just tell them, like, "Listen, I don't like when you say this."
Some people are really persistent.
Like, yeah.
They'll, like, keep judging you.
Especially, I'm Arab, especially from the Arab community. You just have to tell them. And, you know, if you appeal to their emotional side by saying that it hurts your feelings and it really hurts you, which it does, and don't be afraid to say that, by the way. Don't be afraid to say, "It hurts me." As a guy, don't be afraid to say that, right, as well. Then, not saying you're a guy. I looked at the guys when I said that, right? As a young lady, don't be afraid to say it really bothers you when you say these things. And really, like, I lose sleep over it. It bothers me. I even asked this big white guy one time what to do. He couldn't give me a good answer. Like, tell them that it really, really bothers you. I don't think any person with a heart would be able to continue after that. If you really appeal to them. Remember the first step, though. Try to email so you're not really emotional. You just let it out there. If they keep doing it, then just try to appeal their emotional side and just say, "It really hurts my feelings." Right? After that, if they keep doing it, then they're Voldemort.
I was just wondering, how would you advise someone to become more motivated in changing themselves Islamically? Like, if they know, or this is just an example, like with prayer, they know they need to get on it in a better way or on a better timely basis, I guess.
Mm.
What would you say to have them motivate themselves into doing that, or just stopping bad habits?
A lot of how to self-motivate is through introspection and reflection. And remember what we said about why we do things is because it's good for us. And why we don't do things is because they're bad for us. So that person needs to reflect on, when I pray, what good happens to me? What goodness do I feel? And how is my relationship with Allah increased? Like, how does that change my life now? If I get up and pray afterwards, how does my life get better? If I do bad things or make mistakes, how does that hurt my life? You have to do a lot of self-reflection. A lot. You know how the teachers, they always tell you when you're in English classes to write an outline? And no one likes doing it, right? But for the majority of people, when you write an outline, your paper ends up being better. Because you put a little bit of work up into it, right? It's the same thing with Islam. If we can write an outline and put a little work into it, we'll find ourselves improving. The problem is a lot of people say they want to improve, but they don't. So in order to get that self-motivation, you have to open your eyes, or my eyes, or anyone else's eyes, have to be open to the reality. Which is, this makes me better by 1, 2, 3 ways, or this hurts me by X, Y, Z, right? So just open their eyes to the reality. And at the end of the day, I mean, like, it comes down to their own self-motivation. Like, you can try little things here and there by reminding them, but it all comes down to them.
This question I have for you is that through the transformation process, like becoming a better person, I know you'd like, we've done things in the past, feel guilty for them
mm-hmm.
at times. I guess what part does the guilt play in, like, I guess in Islam? Because like sometimes becoming guilty, like feeling guilty, can end up like making you depressed instead of being motivated.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so I guess like should we ask for forgiveness and then at that point forget about the issue, or should we continuously like think about it? You know, like at that point, how do we get across that bridge?
That's a very good question. There's a story that comes to mind. It's called the Battle of Qadisiyah. Have you ever heard of the story? So it's the Battle of Qadisiyah, and it was a battle between the Arabs and the Persians, right?
Muslims.
And this, no?
Muslims,
I'm sorry, not Arabs, well, subhanAllah. The Muslim Arabs of the time, right, and whoever was with them, and the Persians, I apologize, wow, my brain fart. Okay. So, Allah Muslims,
So there was a battle under the, it was under the Khilafah of Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu anhu. And there was a man named Abu Mihdin. Abu Mihdin, he was a Sahabi. And he had a really interesting habit. He used to drink a lot of alcohol. A lot. To the point where he became drunk multiple occasions and would have to go through the punishment of being drunk or whatever in public. One time during the battle, he was caught drinking. And because they were in a battlefield situation, they weren't able to like take him to court and everything. So they had to put him in the house of the general. The general was Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. So they put him in the house of the general, and he's there, and he's caged under house arrest. This is someone who knew the Prophet, so someone who was alive, who was considered a Sahabi, and who had an alcohol problem. He was caught during defending the Muslims, which is like an amazing ibadah. He was caught during that time in the battle, drinking. So they put him now in the house of Sa'd. Everyone knows that he drank. He has every reason to be depressed, feel guilty, feel upset. He made a mistake. He made it in public. He made it during one of the most critical times of the Muslims being together. He made a huge mistake. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas' wife is inside the house, and he's like, he's tied up to a pole or something, so he can't move. And he's crying. And she basically tells him, like, why are you crying? Like, what, like, you made the mistake. And he goes, I need a way to fix it. I need a way to fix it. Like, I have to do something to fix it. See, at that moment, he could have just wallowed in his own misery, you know, and sat in that spot and just cried and you know, basically become depressed. Or he could have done what he actually did. He took the energy of sadness and he turned it into change. What you have to do is you have to realize, oh, by the way, what he did was he begged Sa'd's wife, begged her to let him go. She said, no way, I'm not going to let you go. Not going to happen. You're a prisoner. You're there. He begged her. He's like, please, 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 let me go and fight. Let me go continue to fight. Let me go continue to defend and fight for the Muslims. So not going to happen. So finally he promised her. He said, listen, if you let me go, and I'm alive. If I die, then I die. He goes, if I'm alive, I'll come back, and I'll tie myself back up, and I'll sit here. Like, I'm not going to escape. Don't worry. She said, fine. Right? I'll take your word. So he goes. He takes a sheet or like a cloth and ties his face up so that his face is covered, his identity is hidden. And he gets on a horse and he starts riding like crazy towards the battle, and he goes back and he like does a lot of damage. Doesn't die, doesn't get hit at all. When Omar sees him, or I'm sorry, not Omar, when Sa'd sees him, Ibn Waqqas, he says, that guy looks really familiar. He goes, if I didn't know that he was tied up in my house, I could have swore that was Abu Mihdin. Because Abu Mihdin was a really good fighter. So he saw his style and he was like, dang, that guy can fight. He's like, Abu Mihdin. But that guy's in my house. It's not Abu Mihdin, right? So afterwards, he goes back and he ties him up in the house, or he goes and ties himself up. He's alive. He goes back. But look at what he did. Again, he could have become angry, depressed himself, and not done anything. Or he could have done what he did, which is Tawbah. Tawbah is exactly what Abu Mihdin did. Tawbah is to recognize the mistake. He drank. Is to repent, right? When he was crying, he was repenting to Allah. I apologize, Allah, I'm so sorry. And the third thing was to make up for it, to do something to make up for it. And the last part that a lot of scholars mention is you have to swear that you're never going to do it again. If you fall into it again, that's chance that happened, but don't intend to do it again. Like, oh my God, I missed Fajr. Oh, well, astaghfirullah, probably going to miss tomorrow. Like, that doesn't matter, right? That's not like a proper tawbah. Proper tawbah is, I missed Fajr. Man, I gotta go to bed earlier, I gotta set an alarm, I gotta do it right. I don't ever want to miss Fajr again. And I'm gonna take every precaution necessary to try to wake up on time. So you can easily become depressed, like you said, or guilt-ridden, but realize that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives you, like he says in Surah Al-Furqan, he says, فَيُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِكَ حَسَنَاتٍ. When you ask for forgiveness, Allah turns your bad deeds into good deeds. So if everyone, actually let's do this right now, okay. Allah gives is a very interesting proposition that we're going to do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Furqan, he gives a very interesting statement. He says that this person, he describes a person that is guaranteed the hellfire. They're a fasiq, they're a hypocrite, they did all these terrible things. He said for them is double the punishment, right? Two times. And then he said, إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ. Right? So the first step, إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ. Everyone say, Astaghfirullah. For every sin that we've ever committed, we ask Allah to forgive us. إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ. Everyone say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah.
وَعَمِلَ عَمِلًا صَالِحًا. Look to your brother or your sister and give him a big smile. Okay. فَأُولَٰئِكَ, Allah continues. فَأُولَٰئِكَ, for those people. يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will flip سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتْ, all their bad deeds into good deeds. We are all walking out of this room tonight with no bad deeds. It's pretty baller, isn't it? And the great thing about this deal is that it never expires. You can do it every day. But you have to do it with sincerity. Right? You have to do it with sincerity. We all did it right now, and at the end we kind of felt really good. You're like, dang, that's awesome. Right? That feeling has to happen every time you do it. Right? So the way to get out of that guilt and depression is to realize and harness that energy and turn it towards good. Inshallah. We have time for one more question. Oh, so the Prophet he promises houses in Jannah in different levels, one in the outside, one in the middle, one in the inside, very different levels. And the part that we quoted was he said that he promises a palace or a mansion or a house, an estate in Jannah in the middle for the person who gives up a debate, an argument, they leave it, even if they're right, he said. Even if they're right. So, and you're in an argument, you're like, but I'm right, that person's wrong. I'm right. Well, if you want that house in Jannah, just give up. Be like, okay, that's fine. We disagree, it's okay. And just back out, right? The Prophet, he's teaching us this to de-escalate fitna between us, right?
Assalamu
alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum. So how do you help transform somebody that feels like they've already transformed? Does that make sense? Like, because like, I have an aunt, and she's kind of like a dictator. In the relationship, like, she wears the pants. I mean, she makes more money than
she wears pants.
But like, she's had a hard past, but now she's like much better, mashallah. She's giving da'wah and everything. But it's just like, when it comes to like, you know, the whole treatment with her husband, she kind of regards that from the Quran, and like she's preaching something, but she's doing something else.
Mm.
So it's like, how do you help transform somebody who already, one, feels like they've transformed, and two, I don't want to say hypocrite, but it's just like, okay, hypocrite.
Well, hypocrite in English means a lot different than hypocrite in Arabic.
Okay, the hypocrite in Arabic.
So hypocrite in English, okay. You know, it's tough, honestly. The sour answer is that sometimes you can't. You know, the Prophet stood at the deathbed of his uncle. He stood at the deathbed of his uncle and asked his uncle to say one word of faith, and his uncle wouldn't do it. So, you know, Prophet Nuh, alayhi salam, his family ditched him. Prophet Lut, some of his family ditched him. So, even the prophets had trouble sometimes with their family members. So I guess in that way, Allah is granting you a sunnah, right? But at the same time, you just work on your relationship with them and being consistently there for them. I think part of it, sister, is that we have to start, our community has to start embracing this culture of transformation in the sense that we have to be able to admit and get everyone to admit that we always need to move forward. There's not a point that you hit. I think a lot of people who go through like this religious awakening, they hit a point where they think that they've made it. I have a relative who became religiously aware, I think at age like 35 or something, and he's kind of reached that dictator status as well, the problem is he never ever thinks that he's wrong anymore, because he, I think, was so disgusted with his old lifestyle that he can't accept the fact that even now that he's recognized Allah's grace and blessing on him, that he can sometimes make mistakes. I still have yet to figure out how to do it. But I think the only thing that we can look at is the precedence of the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ constantly just worked through people by being kind to them and taking them and doing things for them that they never expected. I think that really just the way that you treat people speaks volumes about how they're going to react to your advice. If you treat them very, 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 very well, then they'll react. Sometimes they won't react. Sometimes they're just going to, you know, pass away the way that they are. And that's part of the struggle. But that doesn't mean that we ever stop trying. So when the person said that, I don't want to be Muslim anymore, I don't want to be Muslim, the Prophet didn't give up on them. You know, Khalid ibn Walid, he killed Sahaba.
he killed some companions. You know, Almar terrorized some companions, but they became the best. But some of them who didn't convert to Islam, the Prophet never gave up being nice to them. Right? So the way that we treat someone is not based on the result that we want. The way that we treat them is based on the command of the Prophet, which is treat everyone the best that we can with ihsan. The result is up to them and Allah. All right, that's a very good question, though. It's tough. It's tough because you hate seeing people that you love, you know, do that. But sometimes you can even, by the way, this is another story that we can tell, you can even, through your own reflection and transformation, inspire them. For example, admitting that you're wrong about something in front of her might help her admit that, you know, maybe something she does is wrong.
She never admits.
She never admits?
I swear, she doesn't.
Well, maybe like when you're near her, just like, I don't know, just feel like, man, I made a mistake the other day. And just like tell her something, I don't know. Because like I feel like that helps people take their guard down a little bit. You know, you have people who are like are in a fight, they get into a lot of arguments, and then the person comes back and I'm so sorry, like, no, I'm sorry. It's like two people apologizing. It's like you both hated each other 5 minutes ago. And you would never apologize until one of you apologized. And then the other one starts apologizing. And now it's like a never ending apology. And you're gonna start fighting again over who apologizes more. Right? So if you can get someone's defense down a little bit by just kind of being like, yo, we're all human. I've made this mistake. Maybe that'll help. Allahu a'lam. Good question.
Takbir. Takbir. Takbir.
Well, that was okay.
Three takbirs.
Three takbirs at a funeral. Like.
Yeah. Nah, I mean, but this is just a token of our appreciation for the Abdel-Rahman Murphy. Thank you for coming out.
Pat, really quickly, sorry. Now that we're concluding, I just wanted to say one thing. A lot of you might see me in a certain light, but I'll be the first person to say this, that it's my honor and pleasure to serve you. I'm not like a celebrity or anything like that. But like whenever you need anything from me, feel free to reach out. And please don't ever ask me to retweet you. I'll do it, you don't have to ask, right? Please just treat, you know, when you see me, please don't think of me as higher than you. I'm just like you, in fact, I'm probably lower than you. I'm just here to help whatever I can, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair for inviting me. I love you all for the sake of Allah. Assalamu alaikum.